Assalamualaikum, ladies and gentlemen. I had an opening statement, but given the paucity of time, I think we will straight go into the questions that we have for the elite panel that I'm hosting today. First of all, Governor Saab, we have a sizable tech-savvy, but at the same time, one of the highest unbanked population in the region. While our neighboring economies embark on digital financial inclusion programs, what are your views on the need for us to create and implement a national digital strategy?
I think that, good morning, everyone. Assalamu alaikum. And the question should be put to the bankers instead of the policymaker. I can only support the cause. I understand and I fully support the value. And it's not so good when you compare Pakistan with the other countries in the region in terms of how far they have gone in terms of digital banking, branchless banking, transformation of the overall banking system. And I think we have been struck up, but listening to Nadeem Hussain just now gives me a lot of hope towards a future journey. I think it is all linked up with how the overall economy is doing. And it is linked up with the overall system of the political system or the continuation of the political process. You can't have independent things running in spite of trouble going on in the country. And I am not referring to trouble from a political standpoint. All I am saying is that if Pakistan has a continuation of the political process, I think that will give, and Pakistan truly comes out, which it has come 90% in terms of the law and order situation, Pakistan truly will embark on a journey where opportunities will come far and wide, and not just the Pakistani players, but the global players will come here and experiment, because you have the numbers. I mean, we are talking about millions in everything that we talk about, whether they are mobile phone, smartphone users. It starts from there. How much are the numbers? So if you have the numbers and a very, very expanding, fast expanding, educated middle class, then it's only a matter of marketing reach, innovation and marketing reach. Not even innovation, because most of those things are available in the rest of the countries. So you need to just copy them and introduce them and do a lot of marketing. I think also our bankers have to also start taking some risk. The easy thing is to lend and to government securities, in government securities, and think, look at the bottom line and be happy about it, that your shareholders are happy because you're making so much money and giving so much of return. I think apart from everything else, the bankers also need to look into the possibility of the outreach. The easy thing is to invest, like I said, in government securities or to lend to big businesses. That's the easy part of doing things. But I think the competition will come and replace them if they are not ready to innovate themselves.
Thank you. Jameel Saab, State Bank has been extremely proactive in nurturing financial inclusion and penetration. What suggestions would you like to share with our banks to further improve upon their contribution towards inclusion agenda, particularly using digital as a lever?
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim.
And the second part of the question is that we keep on hearing the underlying profitability of branchless banking. Do you think it is working in this country?
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Thank you very much, Bukhari Saab. Assalamu alaikum and good morning to everybody. I think before I dwell upon some of the suggestions for the bankers, let me put the things in perspective in the context of Pakistan's situation with regard to the financial inclusion. According to a survey conducted by one of the well-recognized global organizations. There are 25 countries in the world which are most financially excluded, and they constitute around 73% of the world's unbanked population. And we, out of that, we are comprising about 5.2%. So we are one of the significant financially excluded countries. And that's the reason this topic has become a very important for us as the central bank, as well as for us as a nation. So we have realized this challenge, and that's the reason the financial inclusion is one of the top agenda at the Central Bank of Pakistan. And according to the Vision 2020, our strategic plan which we have put in place in 2015, the strategic objectives which we set for ourselves are that by 2020, we will be increasing the banked population, adult banked population, to 50%. Because as per the surveys conducted in 2008, this number stands at around 12%, and it slightly increased to 23% by 2015, as per 2015 survey findings. So that means that only 23% of the adult population of Pakistan have access to formal financial services. So what we have set as an objective is that by 2020, we will increase it to 50% of the population. Now, why and should we do it? Because we feel that if the most of the population stay financially excluded, then they will not be playing their role and contributing much in the economic development. So access to finance is one of the important factors which will contribute to economic growth of the country. So that's the reason we have set this challenge, and for that we have a number of initiatives which are in the pipeline. Some of them has already started implementation, and we have been in contact with the stakeholders to take various steps to promote financial inclusion in the country. The good thing is that as per one of the recent reports published in one of the leading magazines, which is The Economist, we are one of the top five countries which have started taking concrete actions to promote financial inclusion. So, and some of that, those initiatives are also visible in the numbers which we see. And some of those numbers are shared by Nadeem Hussain also. So I will just let you know that we have now a number of mobile wallets close to 33 million. It's a big number, but the downside is that out of that, I mean, only 15.5 million are active mobile accounts. So which means bulk of them are inactive. They are not being used actively by the account holders. So the challenge for us, as well as for banks and other stakeholders, is how to mobilize these accounts properly and to make them fully operational and active, and to increase the deposit level as well as access to other financial services of these account holders. So that's a challenge. And in order to address that, I mean, we have been working closely with the stakeholders. I think the environment for us is very conducive. And the reason for that is that we have most of population, which is the young population, they have access to mobile accounts. They have access to telecommunication facilities, including internet, which is being offered at a reasonably low affordable levels of charges. So that's the reason people can afford, but I think the challenge is to bring those people to the formal financial sector so that they can start availing the financial services. I think few suggestions for the bankers which I have is that, first of all, I think as well as for other stakeholders, the interoperability is a big challenge. We have many players in this market, banks as well as telcos, and they have put in place infrastructure. They have appointed agents also. Number of agents has increased now to 420,000. But those agents are working for the single banks and telcos. They are not being shared. Similarly, other infrastructure which have been put in place by banks and telcos, everybody is close, keeping it close to their own chests. So they are not sharing. So interoperability means they start collaborating, they start sharing of the infrastructure, agents, and other facilities for the sake of growth of this industry. And we have been now closely working with banks and as well as even telcos and some other place. And we have set this as an objective that we have to achieve the interoperability. And for that, whatever regulatory measures are required to be taken, we will take those measures. Besides that, I think financial literacy is another challenge. That's the reason we have launched recently a very ambitious project. And we have started coordinating through our National Institute of Banking and Finance, started coordinating, and we have also engaged some key experts in this area. And the target for us is that within 5 years, we will provide financial literacy program for around 1 million people. But that's, I think, is not enough. The other players will also have to play a role. Banks, for instance, they can have their own customer education programs, and similarly, telcos can play a role. Then capacity building of the banks. I think the bankers mostly, they are comfortable by providing the usual banking facilities and not paying much attention to the capacity building of their staff to engage them in the technology-based solutions for the customers. So that's another area which can be looked into. Then collaboration between fintechs and banks. I think they have to come closer to each other because fintechs have the technology-wise, they have an edge and they understand the products based on technology. Banks maybe they are lacking in that area, so they have both of them have to collaborate to create synergies for themselves so that they can utilize their resources effectively. I think some of these measures will contribute in promoting financial inclusion and utilization of fintechs for this purpose.
Okay, thank you. You have actually answered quite a few follow-up questions that I had for you in your first statement. But I think the shared services is an issue which is going to be a hindrance in the sense that every bank has its own platform and nobody is sharing the services. So that's a very important aspect which has to come into play. But I will, as a follow-up question, do you think the regulatory environment is in line or in sync with the technology development that is taking place today?
I think we are also in the learning mode. I will not say that the regulatory environment is very conducive, but a good thing is that we are quite open to any new suggestions. And recently we have, at our payment system department, we have established a separate unit, which we call FinTech Facilitation Unit. And the purpose of, there are two purposes of this unit. One is that they will study the existing trends in growth of FinTechs and the new emerging trends globally. And second objective is that they will endeavor to bring fintechs and banks closer to each other so that they can facilitate both of them to utilize their services and contribute in the growth of this field. So any new suggestions, we are very welcome. Another very ambitious program which we are going to launch is the adoption of a sandbox approach. Some of the other regulatory authorities and central banks, they have adopted it, whereby any potentially, I will say, success fintechs ideas, we will provide them a conducive regulatory environment outside of the normal regulatory framework so that those ideas can be tested.
We were sitting at the table and you showed me a graph of the development of the fintech and the regulatory environment. Would you want to share it with the larger audience as to what is the China experience and what is the Indian experience?
Well, can I come back to that, actually?
Okay. Sure.
As in the context of my obsession with the lack of financing of the development sectors in Pakistan. I will address that in a second. You know, we have a very small banking sector. I don't want to harp on this because I do this in every single forum I end up in, and so I have to be taken off the subject very quickly. 32% India's of GDP, India's 60, Bangladesh is about 57. Private sector lending, in our case, 15% of GDP. These other two countries and Sri Lanka, so South Asia, is more than three times that. India is four times that. And of private sector lending, only 15% goes to the development sectors, which is SME, agriculture, and housing. Housing is 0.2% of GDP. Even India, which is low, is 9%. So we have a major problem. Now, what can digital do for all this? And are banks moving in that direction, and what have other countries done? If the SME sector and if agribusiness doesn't develop, we face really a serious risk of premature deindustrialization, because the SME feeds is a conveyor belt. The SME should be the back end of a value chain for our large LSM, for the large-scale manufacturing. They should be doing parts, components, they should be small chemicals integrating into supply. It's not happening. The SMEs are being hit by two things. The FTA, particularly the FTA with China, has had a very damaging effect. And then the fact that our larger businessmen import materials instead of really developing a proper backward value chain. So there is this risk of the conveyor belt breaking down from SME into larger industry. Now, how can banks address this? Frankly, we have to draw a very sharp distinction here between financial inclusion and inclusive growth. The two are not the same thing. Financial inclusion is simply being able to do what you're doing today through another channel. So you'll end up with a bank account, and instead of a checkbook, and a credit card, you'll have you'll have a debit card, and you can access your phone you can access your account on the phone. Fine, excellent. It's an alternate way of delivering services that exist. By itself, it does not create new business. By itself, it does not create new opportunity. So inclusive growth comes from using digital to leverage much more than simply managing your account through digital means or through a mobile phone. Now, we've got a lot of digital initiatives bubbling up, and banks are by no means in the front, as I think Mr. Nadeem Hussain has pointed out. We've got the telcos. The telcos lead, clearly, here, like they do in parts of Africa. The telcos are right in front. They have led with payments. Now they're adding credit to payments. And those telcos like Telenor, which are linked with microfinance banks, have a huge pipeline of customers who they can whose data they can evaluate, segment, and come up with credit scoring that will allow credit to be done in the future without actually even meeting on a digital impression. So that's what they're doing, but they're not so far getting involved with e-commerce. That might change, but e-commerce needs some things to be built and some regulations to be relaxed and flexibility to be given. And then the area of logistics. So let me just, Mr. Nadeem Hussain talked about Alibaba. Alibaba transformed the outlook and the strength and the power of the Chinese SMEs. What Jack Ma saw when he launched Alibaba in 1999, he saw incomplete markets. He saw producers who lacked market information, lacked price information, lacked access to markets. Spread out, I'm talking about the SMEs. And he saw consumers who lacked access to credit. Banks weren't lending more than 20% of their total lending, more than 20% to the SMEs and consumers put together. So he thought that gap could be filled by internet, that the internet could achieve things that the banking system was not achieving. China did not have high street shops. China did not have shopping malls. So you didn't have that mechanism working, and the banks weren't coming into the market either to help connect potential production with potential consumption. So incomplete markets. So he set out to do four things when he launched Alibaba. He said his aspirations were to help the SMEs make money, to try and ensure that producers and consumers could do all their business online, to create 1 million jobs, and to change the social and economic fabric of China. Well, as of last year, he'd created 33 million jobs, the total sales from the Alibaba platform of $550 billion. He's got 4 million SME borrowers. He's got 100 million consumer borrowers. All of them have been data scored, based on predictive loss models, predictive credit risk models that Mr. Nadeem Hussain was talking about. And he promises people 310 loans. 310 is 3 minutes filling the form, 1 second downloading the funds, meaning approved and disbursed in 1 second, zero human intervention. And if they start 310 loans here, once they've got comfort with the data, a year from now, 18 months from now, I don't know, but they will spread out a lot. Now, he didn't just so when he set up, what did he do? What was the first thing he did? Digital windows or digital platforms, offered a digital platform so SMEs could show what they had. He says that there was nobody nibbling. First, people were reluctant to put their wares, display their wares, and then for 2 months there were no buyers. So he realized that something had to happen, otherwise this whole damn thing would collapse. So his company bought, for 2 months, for 60 days, they bought everything that was displayed themselves. But then the market gradually caught on. So once digital sales started, he realized he needed a payment system, because it was a block, the delay in payments was a deterrent. So he created a payment system, Alipay. Then he realized logistics. It took, the delivery period was long. So he bought a logistics company called Sinow, bought 51%, so it's part of his stable. And he put 46% into another very large logistic company called Best. But further for the SMEs, now his delivery promises same day, if you're buying in the same city in China, 24 hours anywhere in China, and 3 days anywhere in the world. Whether he always meets those targets, I don't know, but those are the standards he set for himself. He's done more than that for the SMEs. He has given them cloud computing, and he says that's cut their cost, their technology cost, by 70%. He helps them gain some advantages of scale that they don't have by pooling their purchases. So if they want to buy a particular raw material, he'll get them bulk discounts, because he'll get 1,000 to 10,000 SMEs ordering together, so that the order placed is big. And they then have access to the same prices as large manufacturers. The same thing, aggregating sales. If they get large orders, the SMEs, that they can't execute themselves, he's got a platform that will check identical producers, SME producers in the market, pool the order, and get the sale transacted again, access to advantages that LSM has, large-scale manufacturers have, but he's providing that to the SME sector. And then, importantly, consultancy. They can, if they want foreign regulations checked up, if they want foreign customs rules checked up, if they're exporting, he's got a whole consultancy on that. Also, domestic law, labor law, etc. Runs a ready consultancy. He, like I said, cloud computing. Anyway, you put all those things together, that's the power of the Alibaba platform. He's got many more things besides. He's bolted on media, he's bolted on entertainment, he's got price comparison platforms. So if you want to check Alibaba prices with prices on Amazon, he's got a service, or any other online vendor, He's got a service that'll help you get the best price, and it doesn't have to be a company on the Alibaba platform. Now, are we going to go in that direction? That has changed. That's changed the outlook for SMEs. And if we want to, if we want banks to play a role, first they've got to figure out what segment of the SME market they want to be in. But critically, they have to think, how are we going to add value to the SMEs? just seasonal lending, you know, 6 month loan, he sort of borrows, sells his stuff, pays you back, good. He is as big as he ever was. If you cannot build value in his business, if you cannot connect him out into chains, if you can't help him bring down costs through giving him some scale advantages through some of the things I've described, if you can't get him financially literate or computer digitally literate so that he can use cloud computing and build up a technology for information access, market, news about market, news about prices, if he can't do that himself, then he's got a problem. But if you can achieve that for him without him having to buy expensive technology through cloud computing. So those are the elements of what will be needed, over the next 2-3 years. Who will do it first? Will it be banks? Will it be fintechs? Will it be telcos? Don't know. It's interesting. We'll need to see. But it needs to be done. Our banking sector can't scratch the surface of development in the country. It's got to take the major responsibility for development. We have an 80% private sector. Banking sector, privately owned banking sector, and it can't. And the State Bank rightly is does not direct lending. Now India has a 73% publicly owned, nationally owned sector, plus directed lending. China has a 95% publicly owned banking sector. So those people can get money down to where they want. In a way, the government of Pakistan cannot. Provided the government of Pakistan had objectives for SMEs, but I'm not sure that there is anything so granular. Now, to go back to your question about China and India vis-a-vis fintech and market coverage, China has about 27% of all lending in China is what they call the shadow banking. In other words, this is credit, market credit that's crept up outside the banking system and outside any regulator. And the central bank knows it's happening. What you've got is an accommodative regulator that has allowed fintech related, as I explained to you, Alibaba is the biggest, it's by no means the only platform doing these things. There's also this thing called Tencent, where the head of that is also Ma. He's called Pony Ma, as opposed to Jack Ma. So when the regulators saw the virtuous effect of this activity on the ground in terms of productivity and consumption, they decided to leave it alone and not monitor it and not regulate it till it had got to a larger size. They are beginning to regulate edges of it now, but it's done its job and it's proved its worth, and I don't think it's going to be obstructed. India, on the other hand, from the beginning, the Reserve Bank of India, the central bank, was very reluctant to have any financial activity carried out outside banks. And it, number one. Number two, it was very reluctant to let banks outsource any services to the non-regulated sector, so the banks had to do the end-to-end servicing of all their business. Now, India is beginning to relax. India has now given payment licenses for payment banks. And most recently, India has given, the RBI has given licenses for non-bank NBFCs for crowdfunding. Now, the limits for crowdfunding are small. It's 10 lakhs per borrower. However, that, again, is the beginning of, banking activity outside the conventional banking sector. And therefore, China, which has a very high degree of investment in fintech, India has a lower degree. We have the least so far, but this one investment by Ant Financial in Telenor, is beginning to change the pattern, and we've just heard a prediction of another big one next year. So perhaps our fintech investment is going to go up, and with that, our financial inclusion. But financial inclusion is not enough, as I said in the beginning. It's got to be inclusive growth. So the kind of things that Alibaba has done is that our platform has to deliver, whether bits of it deliver, whether there is cooperation between banks, fintechs, and telcos to create a centralized platform, I don't know. And who leads it, I don't know. We'll see. But it will be an interesting time ahead. And I share the belief that digital will really be transformative for Pakistan.
Thank you.
I'm sorry, you probably expected a short answer, but you got me on a sore point.
We've covered everything that we wanted to. You have said digital is going to grow, so we need to grow the intellectual capital on the digital platforms, and we need to promote the incubation centers that are operating in this country. We have seen some efforts from the government of Pakistan in developing that. Can we see some more action from the government on this side, plus take the private sector along with that?
I think the government has initiated and it has to work with the private sector. There's no two opinions about it. The beginning has been made. It's not a major thing that has happened, but it's the beginning. And I think along with some of the input that the private sector, I know the Ministry of IT is working with a number of companies to take input from the digital standpoint, from the transformation standpoint. And in the coming months, not years, in the coming months, I can easily say that a major initiative will be launched that will reach out to many people. I think one of the problems with Pakistan is the whole scope is so limited. One, for example, here, just the fact that 90% of the Pakistanis don't even understand English, and the fact that our communication is only in English, you can imagine how much is the exclusion. So we are talking about the inclusion, and here we are making it absolutely impossible to reach out to the common people. How, unless the common people, because we are talking about the numbers, the Alibaba story that Salim was talking about, the Chinese story, the most important thing for any new technology or for any new product or service is the marketing aspect, the promotional aspect of it. And it has to be reinforced again and again and again for everyone to reach out. So the traditional banking has not reached out to the common Pakistani. Now we are talking about digital banking and transformation on a scale which only makes sense when you are talking about huge numbers. I mean, you are not talking about few thousands. You have to talk about millions and millions.
But this is the platform which will provide that.
Yeah. So, I'm not denying that this is not the platform and this is not a good initiative. Of course, this is a good initiative. But all I'm saying is that unlike what has happened so far, both from the government side and from the private sector, because I mentioned private sector, like Salim mentioned, you mentioned 80% banking is in the private sector. So 80%, if it's in private sector, though really the responsibility comes from the private sector as such.
True.
And like I said in my first statement, that if the idea is to make money, then the traditional banking will continue. Why should someone start taking risk? Habib Bank is very happy with its bottom line, and which is expanding all the time. And the shareholders are extremely happy. The account holders are very happy. So you are delivering to the people who matter. But whether you have the outreach or you want to go into the kind of innovation which is essential for the growth of digital banking, because that's the mantra, I think. That's the mantra for the future. And but it will have its way in Pakistani market. You can't resist it. It's coming. If the private sector feels that both the State Bank of Pakistan and the government of Pakistan has to play a significant role, I think the initiative has to come from the private sector, and proposing all of those options with the government of Pakistan, with the State Bank of Pakistan, for them to. Unfortunately or fortunately, I don't know whether this is a good thing that the government has no say in where the money should go, like it is in India or China, and they are success stories. But when the banks were in public sector, and at that time also, I don't think so, Pakistan was a model country. In fact, the banks were barely surviving because of the financial losses. So forget about the quality of lending and so on and so forth. So I think it has to work together with the private sector. And when I say private sector, I am essentially talking about both the IT companies and the financial institutions.
Thank you. Just taking up a cue from Mr. Salim Raza's comment, and I know it's very close to his heart, the SME lending, but as the central bank regulator, we really haven't seen much of SME lending in the banking sector. And if it is going to move into the technology platforms, what role do you foresee for the banking industry in the lending business?
I think SME financing is one of the area along with the agriculture and housing finance, which are priority areas for us. And that's the reason we have been coming out with various schemes with the support of the government in the form of some of the on lending, which have been the line, credit lines provided by some of the international agencies. So we are now having launched some of the initiatives on that. For SMEs, one of the key initiatives which was launched last year is the SME financing facility focusing on less developed areas and women also. So any entrepreneurs on fintechs having good ideas, and if they are lacking funds, so they can avail financing under those initiatives. And this is a very, I will say, very, very subsidized lending rates which are there. In fact, SBP is providing the liquidity on zero rate of interest, and only banks are charging some of the margins for extending this facility. So funding, I will say, is not a constraint. If anybody has good ideas, potentially succeedable ideas, so they can come forward and can avail financing under this scheme. This is also because of the reason that we are not pinning much hopes on the banks because we don't see many initiatives being taken by banks on innovation as far as the technological use for financial products is concerned. So that's the reason we are encouraging fintechs as well as some of the non-banking institutions, for instance, e-money institutions, that they can fill this gap and can extend technology-based financial products to the customers. And that's the reason if they have any financing side issues, so they can avail those facilities under SBP schemes.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Governor Saab, for all your time. Thank you, Salim, and thank you, Jameel Saab.
Yeah.
This comes to a conclusion.
I would request our chief guest, Governor Sindh, to please give his concluding remarks.
Thank you very much, first of all, for inviting me here. Like I said, it's an important subject, important event, and already I think Nadeem had given me some ideas to use my platform, the platform of the Governor House or the Government of Pakistan, and initiate something that can further the cause of digital banking, and I think I can play a role, and he suggested that Hamza is the right person to take on board and do something about it, and that I will do. Whatever contribution I can make, it's something that is important. Pakistan has to reach out and match what India, Sri Lanka, or even I would imagine Bangladesh is doing. Why should we be lacking behind? All the top bankers, like Shabba Zaidi said, if Pakistan has achieved something great in two fields, the bankers and the doctors you mentioned, the IT guys, please also include in the list. But if we have produced world-class bankers, and world-class bankers means that they have delivered at the world-class stage, so why can't they contribute in their own country? And I'm sure the likes of Nadeem and Salim Raza and all of those people who are sitting here and those among the audience here have the kind of expertise, understanding, knowledge and everything, both from the banking standpoint, also from the IT standpoint, and combining the two, how best to reach out to the people of Pakistan so that people can use simplified processes in to perform their simple banking transactions, whether it is transfer of money, whether it is depositing of money, whether it is payment of bills, or whatever it is. So the beginning has been made. I think we've seen in the last few years transformation. It's all only, as I said, the numbers. Unless the numbers grow in millions, like we have in every other field, we have taxpayers which are just about stagnant. We are around the 1 million mark, and somehow or the other we can't push to the next 1 million or something like that. So I'll use my platform, and I'll obviously try to get the input from the top professionals. I am no professional, and see how we can further add value to this important subject. Thank you very much.
I would thank you, Honorable Governor of Sindh, as well as our esteemed panelists. We'll now proceed for the distribution of shields. I would first invite Mr. Nadeem Hussain to please join us on the stage, and would request our chief guest, Mohammad Zubair Sahib, for presenting the shield to Mr. Nadeem Hussain. We'll also invite Mr. Jameel Ahmad, Deputy Governor, State Bank, to please come forward for his. I would request Hamza Wasi Hashmi and Mr. Shabaz Zaidi to please join us on the stage. We'll request Mr. Syed Salim Raza, former Governor, State Bank, to please collect the plaque from Governor Sindh. The moderator for the panel discussion, Mr. Atif Bokhari, to please. And I would now request Mr. Shabaz Zaidi to please present the plaque to our chief guest, Governor Sindh, Mohammad Zubair. So I would request the panelists and Mr. Shabaz Zaidi and Hamza to be on the stage for a group photograph. I would also request Mr. Nadeem to please join us on the stage. Thank you so much.